This world is not the Christian's heaven. It is merely the fitting up place. It is the scene of our life battles, our conflicts, and sorrows. God takes none to heaven but those who are first made saints in this world through the grace of Christ. Only the pure, the good, and the holy will dwell with Christ when he cometh into his kingdom. Welcome to the Steps to Life Camp Meeting 2011.
Question.
Question. Our sweet potatoes don't last as long as yours do. So how do you keep your sweet potatoes from rotting? And then fungicide. You're going to tell us about fungicides.
All right. Are you talking about sweet potatoes that you've harvested and put in storage?
Yes.
Well, one of the biggest things that I found with most all your storing crops is that, like I've discussed with you right from the very get-go, the soil is a key component. When your soil is alive and rich and your trace minerals are back in your soil and your plant product is getting these trace minerals in them, they're just like, you know, like some of the things I mentioned to you before. There is an immune system within plants. The same as you and I have an immune system, you know, it's different, but it's still there. And when those components are there and the plant has been raised properly and they're harvested properly and at the proper times, the sugar content and its immune system, that is those mechanisms are there, it gives them a lot longer shelf life. Now, that's one of your key points. The other point is with a sweet potato, again, like I mentioned, you take those things into consideration first, and then it's the way you pack them and store them. A sweet potato, for instance, is not like an Irish potato, whether it's a red or white, or even like a Yukon Gold, which is a yellowish potato. There's various other varieties, but a sweet potato requires a dry type, a dry, darker kind of atmosphere that stays somewhat warm. You know, and what I recommend is if you have like banana boxes, take your sweet potatoes. I don't do it this way because I've got like 400 sweet potato sets. They're going to feel that's a lot of sweet potatoes for us. And, you know, so I don't store them a lot that way. But for folks that are raising a few, which we do for our own home use, I take banana boxes. And I'll take my sweet potatoes. And when they're harvested, the first thing right off the front end is I tell my family, when it's usually Seth and I, you saw him up here on the deal, Seth and I are the ones that usually do the digging, and it's all hand dug. I don't use any mechanisms. They're hand dug, and we handle them well. When we put them from the field onto the cart, you know, which is a little trailer I pull behind my little tractor, they're cured, and it takes about 4 to 5 days to cure a sweet potato, and they've got to be in and out of the sun. You've got to have an area that where at nighttime you want to pull them in to get them out of the dew. And in the daylight, you want to bring them out into the sun and they cure. And there's a sap in a sweet potato that's kind of a white, milky material. Well, that white, milky material actually will cure, and it's like it puts a coating on anything that's open to where it never allows anything like bugs and things of that order to help rot the potato. So there's a curing time. You've got to cure them. It's hard to get to just a simple question like that, isn't it? You want to cure them? I don't wash them at all. I absolutely refuse to wash a sweet potato because once you do that, you open them up to all kinds of problems. And I leave them dirty. You know, I'll knock off some of the dirt, but I leave them dusty or dirty enough. Not for the market. When I take them to the market, they're cleaned and washed. But for our own home storage, I leave them pretty much the way they come out of the field, clean them a little bit, and they go in the boxes after they're cured, and then they go into upstairs in my home. I have a storage area to where they go in boxes in these storage areas, which is kind of, it's dark and it's warm. And it stays that way through the year. And I have sweet potatoes right now from last year that we're still eating. Yeah. And that's pretty amazing. Now, one more thing that I'll get, and then I'll get to you, brother, is your wife asked a question about a fungicide. Now, I've had a number of you folks ask me about, what do you do about bugs? Well, you know, the ultimate in organic farming is not to have to use any pesticide or any fungicides. But we're not in heaven yet. I wished I was, and I wished I didn't have to use some of those things. But there are conditions, at least where we live in the South, to where we have high humidity and a high amount of heat, and those two combinations create a bad fungus problem and also a bad bug problem. Now, there are what's called biodegradable, acceptable, USDA recognized organic sprays on both ends, fungicides and pesticides. I brought with me two of the best that I know of that works really well. Now, this is a fungicide. You can get it from gardening.com, and it's called Spray and Go is the company. And the name of the fungicide is PHYSAN-20. I guess it's pronounced Phyosin. Phyosin, PHYSAN-20 is the fungicide. And it's pretty universal. I use it for blighting. I use it for fungus conditions. And the best thing with a fungus is never let fungus get started. So put yourself on a program to where you're using it weekly. PHYSAN. -20. And the company is Spray and Go. And you can find it on gardening.com on the internet. Now, the pesticide that we have used all kinds of different pesticides. And I was just talking to a brother just a bit ago, and some of the pesticides we used to use, they've actually banned it off the market. And it's made it very difficult for some of us farmers that have to have some of these things. And there's a pesticide that we just found about 2 or 3 weeks ago. You're talking about dynamite. It's biodegradable. It's acceptable, again, by the USDA, the organic standards of organic farming. And biodegradable means it breaks down pretty easy, and it doesn't penetrate into the plant and cause the toxicity into the plant that goes to you. Okay, it's, again, you can get it on Amazon.com. The company is Monterey, M-O-N-T-E-R-E-Y, Monterey. And it's called S-P-I-N-O-S-A-D, spinosad. It's a pesticide. It's amazing. It's a plant-derived pesticide. It's biodegradable. And I'm going to tell you, it just takes one little nice bite of it, and they say goodbye. It really works. Potato bugs, we have never seen potato bugs like this year. Oh my, I'm telling you, they would eat the plants from the top to the bottom, and they started overnight, and it happened rapidly. And I tell you, I took this and sprayed once and sprayed twice, and they're gone. They're gone. Cucumber beetles, whatever, they're gone. Now, those are the two of the best. There are others, but this is probably one of the best of the two, of the fungicide and pesticide. Now, I have to say, because of my conscience, ultimately, we're working towards not having to use either or. And while we're in that journey and process of getting there, the soil is your key. Your soil is just like what you're doing for yourself. When you eat well and you take care of yourself well, and your body is full of proper nutrients and those minerals and trace minerals, and all the vitamins and things that you're to have in your body, it builds your defense system to be strong to fight off disease. We don't cure a thing. As a natural practitioner, I taught people for years that I'm not the one doing the curing. Don't give me the glory. It's God's methods. It's the plant matter or the vegetable or the juices. Those are the agencies that we use so that your body can heal. Your body does the healing. When the body is assisted and nature is taken care of and assisted, it will do its work wonderfully. That's a quote from Sister White. It will do its work well. And it's the same way with the plant matter. It's the same way with the soil. When you take that soil and get it alive and get it really moving in its right direction, the stronger the life flow ends up in the plants that gives them the defense system to fight against pests or funguses. It really does work, but it takes time to get there. So while you're getting there, these are a few little crutches you can use.
Does green compost, like winter wheat or rye, planted in the fall and cultivated in the early spring, does it add to the soil, especially the nutrients, some of the nutrients you mentioned yesterday?
Yes. One of the areas I didn't get to yesterday, and I was going to mention that, and you jumped the gun on me, which is okay. Is just no, that was going to be in the next deal, so I can just go ahead and deal with it. Is when you're working with soil, you saw I talked a little bit about doing those cover crops between the rows while your plants get up 6 to 8 weeks old. You know, that is one way of doing your green manures, and that's what it's called, green manuring. That's cover cropping. Now, when you're cover cropping, generally, you know, for your sakes as gardeners, it's a little tougher for me as a farmer because I run a lot of crops all the way up into the cold season. And so it's a little tougher for me to get the green manures completely worked out on your plot the way, it, you know, ultimately all the time. I rotate it more. Anyways, but green manures are generally, you know, materials that you're using from like rye to wheat. And within those ryes and wheats or those grasses, you want something that's a nitrogen builder, a nitrogen holder that develops a nitrogen. So you want some kind of legume. And there's very few legumes that will go through the winter. And the only legume that I've actually found that works great, that your grasses, your wheats, or your ryes, because they grow up tall, there's a legume that actually has been used years, and I've been using it for years, that actually is a crawler, a viner, that will grow and crawl up the grasses. And by the time you come to spring, you got a nap of green manure about knee to mid-leg deep. And I love it because when I know that I've got green manure is, you know, when I deal with the subject of nutrition and I speak on nutrition, there's one thing that you all find out because you've never heard me lecture on nutrition, is you'll find that I really strongly recommend raw food. Amen. Raw food is the life flow to your blood. And there are nutrients in raw food and living enzymes in raw food that are amazing, absolutely amazing. It's like the energy that runs to these lights. It's like the electricity that creates the life that comes through these lights. When you turn the switch on, all of a sudden you let that power loose, and that's the raw enzymes in this raw material. Now, that cover crop material, like I said, when you feed yourself, you better be feeding yourselves the right types of foods to give your body the ultimate lift that it needs. Now you think of that when you're working with the soil. That soil is a living organism. It's a living family there. And you've got to think, now, you know, am I going to starve them to death? Well, that's what America's doing to the soil right now. All but a few fanatical, right-winged, hair-brained hippies that are still thinking, you know, that way, like myself, you know, you just, you know, you got to think, you know, we don't just stomp and walk all over you. You got to feed it. If you want to live, you better feed yourself well. And it's the same thing with the soil. When you feed that soil well, it's going to come alive and it's going to give those plants the ultimate for your benefit. Feed the soil, it feeds you. And green manures, I'll get back to that point. The green manures are the ultimate builder of your soil. It does so many beautiful things to the soil that I don't want to take a lot of time to explain, but it's very important. And the legume I was going to mention to you is Austrian peas. It's a legume family, Austrian peas. You can usually get it through your farmer's co-op, and if the farmer's co-op doesn't have them, they can get them. Because I get them from a farmer's co-op where I live in Tennessee, and it's called Austrian peas. And they grow up, and I'm going to tell you something, they'll grow up that deep. I mean, they'll get amazing. And you can plant them.
So you plant that in the fall with the wheat or the rye?
What I do is I mix equal parts, the wheat or rye, wheat or rye. And then with that, I take an equal parts of the Austrian peas, mix it all together. And I use one of those backpack,
That's what I use.
Whirly bird things. Uh-huh. And I go around the field doing it the old way. And then I take my tiller and I run back through the fields and work them in. I have one section of field right now that's too high clay. It's about less than a quarter acre. And those Austrian peas and the grasses will start breaking down that clay and bringing the life back to that clay to where it'll start feeding it. Clay is a lot of locked up minerals, but it's locked up and you've got to break it loose. And these Austrian peas and grasses will start breaking and mellowing the soil out as I continue to build it. I don't even plant anything on it, and I just planted a cover crop on it 2 weeks ago, and it's already up that tall. And it's by the time it comes to fall, I'm going to work it all in, and when that field is completely ready, which is an acre and a half, about an acre and a quarter ground, I will cover the whole thing in. This spring on that field I'm just telling you about that has a part of clay in it, one end of it, I planted in the fall the wheat and the Austrian peas. This spring when I went out, or late winter, early spring, I went out with my tractor, and I still plow because I do a lot of things the old-fashioned way, and my tractor just doesn't have a big tiller for it. So I plowed it in. But when I plowed it in, that stuff was that deep and it went through the winter. And when we started getting our heavy frost, it started settling down, but it wasn't killing it. And we get some pretty cold weather down where I'm at. And it went, by the time it was that time to plow and put it into the ground, I had a nap about that thick of organic material that went under the ground like this. And when I was working the ground and getting it prepared for crops, you know where the roots were going? Down into that material. Now, when we talk about green manures, one of the things that you have to remember with a green manure, it's just like putting raw manure on your ground. It's hot. And it's hot. And it takes a little time for it to break down and get to the point where you can plant in it. You do not want to plant directly after green manure goes under the ground. You want 2 weeks. 2 weeks before you ever think about planting in the ground. Because the heat of that breaking down composted material really rises. If you've ever been into compost pits like I am, in my muck boots, like I was right before I came up here, turning my huge compost pit all by hand, the heat that comes up off this breaking down material is quite amazing. So you want to give it at least 2 weeks before you start planting in that ground.
Do you know of a good way to get rid of Bermuda grass?
Bermuda grass? No, I don't, to be honest with you. The only way I know how to get rid of anything, you see that? You don't see it over here. You know what that is? Yeah, that's right. It's called callus. And the only way I know to get rid of some of this stuff, unless you use an herbicide, and I don't believe in herbicides, I simply believe in one herbicide, and that's my backbone. You got to dig it out. And I know that's not exactly the news you wanted to hear. A number of companies have come up with various, quote, natural herbicides. Gardens Alive actually has some in there. They recommend it. And how well they work, I don't know, because I don't go there. I mean, you can see up there, you don't see too many weeds anywhere. I was looking before I spoke, but you just don't see very many weeds up there. And you can go right on down through it, and that's all done by my backbone. That's done by those hoes, the stirrup hoe I was telling you about. And when I get obnoxious weeds like Johnson grass, you know what Johnson grass is? Hateful stuff in a garden. And it'll get roots that big. And then the more organic you get, the bigger round the root gets. And it will just spread. And a lot of these grasses are just that way. And if you don't get it out of there, it will take over eventually. One of the things that I've tried to strongly encourage is, you know, don't let it delay. When I was on my bigger farm in Kentucky, I had a Mennonite man, an Amish man. Well, he was Mennonite, wasn't Amish, but there's not much difference between the two. Anyways, he worked for me. And I used to joke with him a bit, and I said, well, Marvin, you're the best herbicide I've ever seen. This man hated Johnson grass. He hated noxious weeds that were in the fields, like dock and various thistles, you name it, man. This guy had a Maddox. You know what a Maddox is? It's like a heavy-duty type of hoe that comes down here like this, and it's made out of steel, and it might have a sharp blade on one end. It's kind of like a pick in a sense, but it's been flattened out on one side. This man lived with a Maddox and a bucket or a wheelbarrow. And I'm telling you what, in 5 years on my farm, there wasn't a burdock to be found. There wasn't a Johnson grass to be found. There wasn't a thistle to be found. There was none of these weeds to be found, because he knew once you let it get started and it propagates, it's history. Like I mentioned to you the other day, and these grasses the same way. As tough as it is, you have got to be determined to whip it. Just like you're determined to be victorious over sin, you look at those weeds as sin, because that's all it is. It's a result of sin. And especially in a garden, you've got to work with it. I know there's mentalities out there that say, we garden and we farm and live with the weeds. Well, I'm going to tell you something. Those weeds take from your plants. They're telling you a lot of things, but they're not good. I'm sorry, I don't have a real good answer for that, but, you know, you've got to get out there and dig it out.
Are you familiar with Dr. Howard Garrett? He said that this, I haven't tried yet, but the vinegar is really effective to get rid of the grass that you don't want. But don't put it in your garden, but like on your driveway, for example, or pathway.
Using what?
Vinegar.
Oh, vinegar. Okay. I know there's another one they recommend. I've never used it because, you know, I'm not going to bring a truckload in.
Yeah, I mean, it's not for the garden.
It's for a small garden area?
Yes.
Yeah. They also, in some of these books or magazines, they recommend there's a corn material that they're using now. And they're grinding certain corns, and they're using it in the ground. And what it apparently is doing, it's killing the root system of a lot of these grasses and weeds. And they're using it as a herbicide, but they use it in the early part of the season before you start planting about 2 to 3 weeks ahead, because it's killing the seeds. Uh-huh. And these grasses, I don't know.
Yeah, and another thing about fungicide, I garden, and the really effective for me is this, you know, baking soda. I use the baking soda. And use a tablespoon of baking soda and mix it a gallon of water, and you spray it. And then if it's Because fungus, it comes from the soil.
That's right.
And it gets, when it gets to roots and it comes to the leaves like that. Mm-hmm. And then you, after that, you need to sprinkle the cornmeal around your plants.
Yeah. Good.
And it will, I mean, like 1/4 inch, you dig it around if it's there already. And you mix that cornmeal with the soil. And then after that, you water it and...
That's good.
It will get rid of it, and I use a lot of organic stuff, and
good.
I don't really use.
All right. Well, that's good. Did y'all get that? I'm not an orthodox farmer. I don't go out there looking like a farmer. I am who I am, and I'm what I am, and I've been that way the majority of my life. As a child, I've been weird. I got into my young adulthood, I was weird, and I'm now weird. And that's okay. So, for whatever it's worth. And this hippie is trying to find Jesus and let him totally change me inside and out. But I can't help it. I'm still, something inside here keeps me to the Lamb. Keeps me where I've been for a long, long time. And I'm just thankful that the Lord Jesus will accept, people where they're at, and he's willing to change us and bring us into a better life. Anyways, I was telling you, we're going to flash through some of these real quick. That was when I was preparing the beds, getting them ready for those 30-inch beds that I was mentioning to you. Runs from right to left 30 inches, and as you go over this way, one way or the other, let's just go back over this way with this crop. That's another 30-inch bed there. And that allows me to have a hoop on here. And I'm going to get to that real quick to explain some of those points to you and the importance of that, of extending your garden seasoning or your growing. And you can see again what we're doing there. I was laying the drip line. I have 2.5 acres under drip irrigation. One of the nice things with drip irrigation, if you ever get into gardening or farming, you conserve water big time. You're not sprinkling stuff. Sprinkling irrigation, you lose a lot of water. The other thing you do is you encourage 9 billion weeds per inch everywhere. And you know what that means? That means at least 100 more hours of blisters. Do you understand that language? Yeah, I think so. So if you drip irrigate, where your moisture stays is right there. And that's what's so nice. It's not out here in your walk path in these areas. It stays within that area. And when you hoe, you're cleaning the area where your plant matter is. Now, when you're hoeing, that brings up another subject. You've got to have the proper equipment, like I mentioned to you yesterday, the proper, like the stirrup hoe. There's other types of hoe, or just a blade that are about 6 inches wide, long and about 1.5 inches wide, that's nice and sharp on one end or side. And when you're cultivating or hoeing your crops, do not use the prehistoric monster when you go out there to do this. That is a hoe. Now, remember, each one of these plants that are growing, the larger they become, the wider the rootstock, the root base is. It's going out to be a feeders, all right? They're not that far underground. When you're cultivating, and the older that plant gets, the less you want to be cultivating deep. You cut roots every time you go deep. There's a lot of farmers or gardeners that use these push cultivators, the high wheel cultivator. You've seen them probably. And you're cutting down 4 to 6 inches into that ground. You're cutting roots. And you remember that. You're cutting the feeder roots that are making life flow to those plants. You have deeper roots, but you have a lot of filler roots that are right up here. So when you cultivate shallow, and that's what that stirrup hoe is so good about. because it has that blade, and you can work the first inch and a half of ground easy, just working it back and forth, just like that. You can go back and forth all the way through it. I wished I had one here to demonstrate it, but it's just so nice to just clean that surface off. And like I was telling you yesterday, my son loves me to death. He hates me when I say, let's go out and do some hoeing. Why? There's no weeds out there. I said, that's just the point. We don't want to ever let them get started. Do you understand me? Same thing with sin. Don't ever let it get started. Once you get it started, it gets harder the older it gets. To get it out of the garden, to get it out of the heart. So don't let it get started. Again, we went through some of these things. We're just flipping through to get up to another point. I think this is about where we got, wasn't it, yesterday? Doing the carrots, getting them ready for market. That's that romaine lettuces. Okay, we're going to see that right there, that hoop. That hoop we demonstrated in March when I came up here, remember? And I think I left with you that the binder. Now, that hoop right there is made out of 3/4 inch conduit, or you can get 1/2 inch. No, I think it was 1/2 inch conduit. And at Johnny's Selected Seeds, which is this company right here, and it's got its address on it, and you can get it later from me if you want. In Johnny Selected Seeds, they have these hoop benders, and they're not expensive. They're like $60-something dollars, if I remember right, in the catalog. And you can bend these hoops, and I have a section of hoops for 150 feet long. I've got 5 of them, and those 5 hoops carry me in the spring earlier, past the frost date, or through the frost date, up past it, which gets me a month early this way. And in the fall, you can see this is the what they call the mescaline mix, spring mix. You're familiar with that, right? The spring mix of lettuces. Well, this is in the springtime, and the reason why you don't see the covering on it here right now, it was actually still cool. It was spring. You can see the broccoli here. See how big it is? We had broccoli the size, as I told you yesterday, the size of dinner plates and bigger. Huge. You saw it earlier, I think, in one of these pictures right there. That's the cauliflower and broccoli. And it was early in the season. Where did I go? Wrong direction. Right there. Early in the season, they were hooped and carried with a cover like this material here, carried with a cover for 200 feet down that direction early in the season so I could jump the market on early broccoli. You know how important that is when you're into growing food? Very important, and especially if you're into marketing. And these hoops as well work, and we'll see some pictures later, works well in the fall time. We carried carrots, beets, and greens, and some lettuces, like that spring mix lettuce, we carried clear up into December, having fresh vegetables all the way up. And we carried carrots and other things, but mainly carrots. If you have never eaten a carrot that's grown and protected in the winter months, you've never eaten a carrot. You talking about sugar sweet. We were selling carrots in January when it was snow out there. I tried to find the pictures, and I could not find a picture to bring you to show you. I'm going to run forward real quick. See, I'm building these hoops now here. See these beds right here? Those beds are actually planted in carrots. And this was in the fall where I was working here. You can see right here, I just had a cover crop starting to come up in here. These are a set of tomatoes that were now done. And after I got the carrots all done, we had to pull all this stuff out. Right there, you see that? Those are sweet potatoes over there. But this was a bed of carrots, 200 feet long, right here, two of them. We carried those beds of carrots all the way through the winter and had carrots in the spring to sell early before anybody else did. By that right there. You cannot do that and leave carrots out in the open. You've got to have a covering. There you go. You can see it right there. That is actually this spring. That one you saw earlier with me building the hoop is actually in the fall of that winter. This one here, you see that right there, that green underneath those hoops? That's 200 celery plants. People do not raise celery in Tennessee. People don't know how to raise celery in Tennessee or a lot of other places. This was cool weather. That right there, you see, this was that corn, some corn, early corn. You can't see it, but it was planted. It's early northern varieties. These here, right through here, from this point here to this point here, are 600 head lettuces. All started with these things right here early. And lettuces will take a cooler weather. They got frosted on three times. Celery will not take frost. It'll take it to some extent, but if it gets too cold, we had like 32 to 35 degree weather right there. Now, you can't see it too well. You see those little things right there and right there, those little darker marks? Those darker marks are little miniature sandbags. They're full of sand. Now, as you look at that hoop, you go over this side and you're over here on this side, on the back side of it here. You can't see it. There's a covering. There is that, what we call agribond. It's a white material right there. That material there, that's a 10-foot piece of material that actually will drape completely over that. That draping right there of that covering actually takes me in the state of Tennessee and moves me 500 miles south. That puts me down in Alabama. You see the importance of that? What you're doing? The man that actually has developed this lives in Maine. He grows produce 12 months of the year in Maine. Now, in Maine, he will double cover this if it gets severe. This here was actually an early crop of radishes right in here. And I had it covered to create a little more heat to protect it 500 miles south. And we had radishes come out of there. It's a mind blower. We had them coming out like the size of golf balls. Beautiful size and sweet, just nice, nice salad radishes. They will double cover it. They will use this and put it over here, and then they'll put a plastic covering over it, and that will send you about 1,200 miles south. I love it. And the simplicity of using these techniques has actually, it's revolutionized gardening. To where people like yourselves that are concerned about hard times, where are we at anyway? Most likely we all won't really feel it because we're used to going to the supermarket and thinking that supermarkets are going to be there tomorrow and to the next day and then the next day. Well, one of these days you're going to go down there and there's not going to be anything. And when that happens, you better be well prepared for the time that's coming right on us. Amen. So, anyways, these hoops have been a real transforming situation. This here, again, you see the hoops here. This is running. That's that one you saw from the other direction. Those are lettuces, and those are lettuces there. You can see that's a lot of spring mixed lettuce, but I'm going to tell you something. There is big money in spring lettuce. I'll tell you that right here and now. That right there, from that point, that's almost the front of the row right here, my main trunk of irrigations here. From there to about right there is 1 pound You know what I get for a pound of spring mix at the market? $8. Do you savvy? Does it comprehend there a little bit?
Yes.
You see how many pounds are in that row? I may got $25 into that row right there. And I'm not even going to tell you what I profit off that row. Spring mix, salad, lettuces, materials are a high dollar wanting material in this country. And I've just found it to be a real, and it's easy to grow. When I was using that, this little, and this is for those that want to grow spring mix. It's very easy to grow. You just need to know a few tricks. This little planter here, the Earthway planter, I take it, and you see that little bed right there? It has a little indent in that bed. I take that Earthway planter, and I take the little chute that has an adjustment to the depth and pull it all the way up. I mark my line with a line, and I make this little trench through here with this thing. The wheels will actually do that, and set a 2-inch, it's about a 2-inch trench. And then I take a little container with a hole in it, and I just go along and broadcast this mixture of lettuces that I buy and mix it myself, the varieties I want. And then I broadcast it in this little trench and bury it lightly, and then make sure it just keeps moisture. So I'll come back along and put my drip irrigation right down the middle of these two trenches. And what it does is it keeps them irrigated and moist, and all of a sudden you'll see millions of little seeds coming up right down that row, which will create that lettuce. And I'm going to tell you something. You can have lettuce all winter long. All winter long. Anyone can do that. We were harvesting, remember that bed of carrots I was telling you we planted? And I was showing you I planted. That's it in the early, early spring. This was that bed, and we were planting the harvesting carrots for market there. And you can see the hoops were still there. You can kind of see the plastic right there that we had it covered with. And it was cool because you can see we're dressed in cooler climate clothing, you know, at that point. All right. One of the points that a lot of people in little gardening have asked a lot about is, and especially the further north you get, there are certain plants that you grow that need extra heat. And there's two ways that I know of really getting that extra heat to grow, like melons and various different plants. And this is, we buy it's a ground covering. It's a plastic material. And I'm basically showing you here what you can do. There's another technique that you can use, but this is a simple way. Now, if it's just you and one other person or just you, you can actually tie a rope onto this piece of tubing here that's a PVC tubing. Drill a hole through it here and drill a hole through it all the way through here on both sides. Tie your little rope on here at an angle, and you can actually walk out of your bed over here on this side, because remember, this is a bed and you don't want to be in it. And you'll walk down and you can pull that by yourself, and it'll stretch that on out. And then you either your wife or your whoever can come back and help you start burying it. And what that does, it actually will take and trap the moisture in. It'll trap and bring the heat into that soil. And what we were doing is we were actually preparing sweet potato beds here. And with sweet potatoes, which most people have ever grown sweet potatoes, I don't know if you can grow them up here not too well, can you? Okay. Well, sweet potatoes, they love heat. And the more heat you can get to them, the better they do. But they also like a moderate amount of moisture. With a sweet potato is a lot of times a sweet potato will go down deep into the ground, and when you go to dig them, it's a nuisance to dig them, and you'll break them a lot of times, and it's a lot of effort to dig them that way. When you put them in a plastic covering like this, you knock a hole in them about every 2 feet with whatever you want to knock it in, and you can come back and plant your sweet potato set right in that hole every 2 feet. Now, at the end of your season, you'll be quite amazed. Right here, you'll see a great big bump like this. Okay, you see it. We're doing it here again. And you'll knock a hole every 2 feet. Well, at the end of the season, this will all be covered up. This whole field was covered up with sweet potatoes. And when you come back, you cut the vines, lay them aside in your aisle here, and you'll see that there's a great big bump right here every 2 feet. I mean, right on the surface of the ground, your sweet potatoes are right there. Right there. I mean, they're right on the top, and very seldom do you have to dig very deep. You can take your potato fork, put it down, and pop them up, and they're right there. Very sweet. It's just nice to have that. And again, that's just a simple technique of laying plastic and then covering them. And it just is, we use it for doing watermelon, cantaloupe, sweet potatoes, and even tomatoes and various other crops that like heat.